Hi, it's me again. I'm making this short review about the PX360M, the Casio PX360M keyboard. And when I read online, there was a lot of raving reviews. It's a number higher, the PX360 compared to the 350. So it's a better keyboard. It's got upgraded visuals and everything. So seemed almost like everything was better. Nothing was worse. The problem with these kind of reviews, they're usually from salespeople, is they want to sell you a device, and so they're gonna accentuate whatever has been improved. Yet, do not face you with issues that you should know and be aware of. Like, for instance, if a salesperson wants to sell you a TV, and it tells you this is just simply the perfect TV. In every circumstance, it's got the perfect color saturation, 3D, 4K, everything that you could possibly think of, and this is the TV to get. So you buy this TV and you get it on in your home, and all of a sudden you notice that the brightness is not bright enough because you have a home with a lot of windows. And so you needed to be aware of the fact that your TV only had 300 or 500 nits of brightness. And when you're not aware of that, that could be a major killer. This TV could be the perfect TV if it's not bright enough. If your outside light is kind of like phasing out your image, then this TV is worthless for you. While somebody else who might have a perfectly dark room, living room or whatever, no light coming in, might be the perfect TV for him. So there are certain things that salespeople just don't want to tell you in advance, or they just don't, you know, they're not critical enough to really address those issues. And so that's what I want to do here with the PX360. So from the reviews, yes, it's a better keyboard. It's a new keyboard. It's got a lot of options. I've been playing with it for 3 days right now, almost straight. I mean, I went to bed 8. And aside from, you know, doing my daily things, I worked on this keyboard nonstop. So all the positives you can find anywhere on the web about the PX360. There's plenty of reviews about how good this keyboard is. And if I have to say, the two main things that stand out on this keyboard is the acoustic piano sounds, like the grand piano, concert piano. They've got a whole bunch of, let me check, there's a bright piano, an LA piano, rock piano. The rock piano and the LA piano sounds okay, but most of the grand pianos are sublime. I would pair it with Yamaha keyboards, piano sounds of similar price. I would definitely put them side to side to Yamaha and have somebody play them. And they would say, this is a Yamaha, this is not a Casio, this cannot be happening. The keys, the sounds are great from the pianos. Aside from the piano sounds, the keyboard is, for me, I find this keyboard perfect. I've played on some of the older 1980s pianos. And when I pressed the keys, they were so heavy that my finger kind of bent backwards because it was just too heavy to play on. This keyboard from Casio, for me, it's the perfect mix between heavy keys and between the plasticky keyboard that you find in the $200 range. So for me, this is the perfect. You can have a lot of sensitivity. So you can go loud and soft, and it gives you a great dynamics. The keys are heavy but not too heavy and not too light. For me, they're perfect. They have this this kind of like matte surface. It's not glossy It's matte. It's like, it feels like rough, like wood or ivory is what some people call it. So definitely what the 360 has, and I believe the 350 has it too, is for me personally, this is the perfect keyboard. Like the keys, the heavy, the weight. And I wonder how they do that in a 20-pound piano to get such a great, great keyboard. Now the downfall, or the bad side, or the other side of the 360. 360 has a lot of problems, and you don't hear that online. People are trying to sell this keyboard, they're not trying to tell you the bad things. So that's what I'm here for. The first thing that I've noticed is that it has a lot of samples in there, but there's only really about two or three good pianos in there that you really want to, you can take them on stage. They're that good. But overall, I would say if you play in gigs with this thing and you're just like an intermediate to a professional musician, you probably would not take more than if you're a professional and you don't want to take your expensive equipment to a birthday party or whatever, this Casio is more than enough for you. You'd have several samples you can choose from. However, I'm telling you, you're going to be happy with about 2 to 10 samples the most. Like some electric keyboards, definitely the acoustic pianos, and all the rest, there's about 512 samples in there. To me, they're garbage. Honestly, they're not garbage. I mean, they've put some effort into making a guitar sound like a guitar. I mean, some of it sounds like a guitar. Some of it just sounds like a clanging cymbal or something. My opinion, they've improved from the WK1800 series. But I don't think it is there yet. It is not something you want to use live. Definitely not. Outside of the occasional instrument that's in there. The general MIDI samples are just absolute crap. They're just bad. I don't even know why they put them in there. Just maybe for MIDI compatibility or something. But yeah, the real samples that you would want to play with, like this is like, I don't know what it is, but the real samples are the pianos, definitely. That's why you want this keyboard. So my first gripe was there's only like about no more than 5 for me personally. If you're tolerant, 10 samples, that's it. Okay, second gripe. The speakers do not have the same enhancement feature as on the 160. The keyboard by itself sounds rather thin. It also doesn't have the brightness on the top. So once you plug in the monitors, the studio monitors, you'll hear an increasing sound quality, definitely on the low end. On the high end, it's still lacking brightness and fidelity. That's what I'm missing on the high end. Even though my studio monitors are expensive, ribbon tweeter monitors, I still feel that, you know, I don't have enough of that bright tone, that fidelity that I get with Roland and with the higher end Yamaha, Kawai, and all the other instruments. So I'm missing out on that with this keyboard. There is another setting. If you disable the internal speakers, let me just check real quick how I can do that. So we have the internal speakers on right now, and it sounds a bit like this. Oh, my apologies. To go to piano. But then when you turn off the internal speakers, it'll sound more flat. It sounds okay. But with the speakers on, it sounds a little bit more enhanced, and I think they could have worked a little bit on the bright and on the lows. And with bright, I mean like anything above 5 kilohertz. We need to hear those hammer actions, those string responses. As a musician, I'm very aware of string responses, like on the bass guitar, on the guitar. When you put new strings on your instrument, it just sounds so much better. And we don't have that here, especially when you turn off the internal speakers. So it sounds almost like you're playing a guitar or a bass guitar with old strings. It doesn't sound nice if you don't have that brightness on there. Which brings me to the second problem, or the third problem actually, which is brilliance. There is a brilliance option in there. Now if I would be playing, for instance, straight from the monitors, so I'm going to take off the internal speakers, and then I'm going to try. This is the sound with just regular brilliance, with brilliance zero. And once I set brilliance to +3, which is the maximum, it sounds like this. Set brilliance to -3. What it does is it doesn't really affect the high frequencies like you would think brilliance would do. Brilliance is usually what they use for anything above like 4 or 5 kilohertz, usually 6 kilohertz. It's kind of like the fret noises, the string noises out of a guitar. That's what brilliance is supposed to sound like. It's not supposed to add to, you see, because if I make this loud, this is the brilliance effect. It just adds mids. It doesn't add, it adds harshness. Harshness, which is good when you're taking this out on stage and you're playing amongst other instruments, it'll give you a cut so you can hear yourself better. However, this piano is supposed to be a home piano. It's not a stage piano. So at home, you will want to have the real brilliance, the real sound quality, because the brilliance that's in here is actually harsh sounding and makes your samples really bad. It makes your sound like the beautiful piano. It makes it just wasted effort for, you know, it's wasted effort for Casio to put so much effort into a keyboard and samples, and then with the brilliance they just kind of messes it up. It's like every detail is just being filtered out with it, and it's just being, you know, sounding harsh again, sounding like a harsh piano. Okay, so we've had the speakers I wasn't too happy about. We've had the brilliance I wasn't too happy about. We've had the samples I wasn't too happy about. I mean, most of the samples are pretty crappy. The fourth thing about samples in specific that I am not happy about is that this Casio is extremely difficult to combine two sounds into one. Like, I love piano with pads, and I've had about, well, a good 6 or 7 pianos from all kinds of brands, ranging from the Casio WK1800 all the way up to expensive Rolands and Yamahas and Kawais and even Fender Rhodes and things like that. I've had plenty of different instruments, ranging from the 80s, where all the internals were still electronics, until the modern keyboards, where especially with the previous, with the Yamaha Clarinova series, they're all digital samples and they sound like crap when you layer the two things together. You get your piano, and then whatever you layer on top of it, it'll create some sort of a sample that you can hear your octave notes on the clarinovas. Clarinovas are said to be great pianos. However, I don't find this to be the case. Clarinovas have digital samples, and when you layer instrument, that's when you see the weakness of the clarinova. Now, so I've been playing with a lot of instruments, and I've noticed that with every instrument, every brand, I could find two or three sounds you could combine. Even if it has 1,000 samples in them, or maybe even 5 or 6 samples in them, there's always one or two that you can combine and it sounds great together. That together they make a much more full instrument. Mostly when you're playing alone by yourself, you would want to have the piano and some sort of a fill up. Like the piano by itself is great, but it dies so quick, the sound, that you want to have maybe some strings or some pads on the background. And those strings or pads cannot stand out too much. Now, I've noticed that with the Casio, it's very difficult to get this kind of thing. It's very difficult for your Casio to have your piano sound and then put a strings on top as a second instrument, because, or even electric piano, because of the inconsistencies between the instruments. It will make always something sound bad. Either the strings are overpowering the piano. Most of the strings that are in here are bright strings. There is no warm pad. I did not find a warm pad in here, which is something that I really think that Casio should have done, is put in samples that can be combined. Because a warm pad with a piano is a perfect example of two perfect matching instruments. They will add to the piano, both on the low end and on the mids, more tone. And the problem is with the Casio is that, first of all, it doesn't have any warm pad. And if you do find an instrument that kind of sounds warm, it's kind of like the warm strings, it kind of fits, you have to put the volume down so much. Because on the higher end, I can even show it to you. It's just way too loud. You see, you have strings, but it totally overpowers the piano. And then on the other hand, you don't hear them. You don't hear them on the bottom. So the strings don't have that setting where you can say, okay, add more strings to the bottom and reduce them from the top end, which is something that the WK1800 could do very easily. So that's one of the problems, the main problems with the Casio. Now, not only the strings, let's say for instance you want to layer a piano, one of their beautiful pianos, with an electric piano. A lot of the electric piano have a sharp and powerful attack that if you want that attack to match the attack from the piano, you'd have to lower the instrument by so much that the sustain of your electric piano is not going to be sounding very good. So, or you can match the sustain of the electric piano with your regular piano, but the attack of the electric piano will be so loud that every time when you play it, it's like quack, quack, quack. It's like a quack sound that just hits you. The attack is too loud. And so the combination of both instruments does not work. I have been playing 3 days with this and I have not found a single instrument that I can combine with another one. And there's not been a single instrument that I've ever played with that I've had such a hard time finding two instruments that fit together. I don't know why. I wish I knew why, but I don't. I don't know why Casio has put so few instruments that match together into their repertoire. One of the problems with Roland that I had in the past was that a lot of those Roland samples are so advanced that if you want the fidelity of a piano that sounds very bright and beautiful, you would want to have something warm on the other side so it doesn't contradict each other. You don't want to have a fidelity piano with a fidelity piano, because they're both, or fidelity meaning like the nice high frequency sounds of synths. You don't want that with a nice high frequency sound of a piano, because it'll overcompensate. So Casio didn't think about that. With their WK15 or 1800 keyboard, it was one of the earlier keyboards that they had in the 2000s, 2005, I believe it came out. Great keyboard at the time and for the price. That keyboard did not have as advanced samples as this one. I definitely have to say the samples from the PX360 are improved and increased in quality compared to the WK1800. But the 1800 sounded so much better on the speakers because it had low end, it had brights, it was more like a hi-fi sound, which is better when you're playing at home. And I hope that Casio is going to make a patch or an update for this so that people who are playing at home with home speakers or even with the internal speakers can have more of the hi-fi quality, what they want, and not the piano, like the mid, that you only hear the mids and nothing of the lows and nothing of the highs. Because, you know, that doesn't sound very nice. If you're the only instrument playing, you will want to sound hi-fi. Cut the mids, raise the or boost the lows and boost the highs. Once you're in a band, the setting that the PX360 has is pretty good. I'm pretty happy about that. Another issue, and I'm getting to 20 minutes already, so I'm going to have to make it quick. Another issue that I've noticed is that this 360 is buggy on external keyboards. If you add an external keyboard, like I have one over here, Alesis, I don't know if you could see it, Alesis QX 61. It's just a MIDI controller. It has a lot of features. Not a lot is actually working with the keyboard. I have to like assign them in some way or another. But I've noticed that it is very hard to use this keyboard and get good sounds out of my Casio because the attack is too loud, sustain is too low. It's too easy to just go from very quiet on the keyboard all the way up to maximum where it's just like pow, you know, while on the internal keyboard on the Casio, the sound is more like linear, like the harder you press the keys, the louder your sound is gonna be. On the plasticky keyboard here, like I call it plastic MIDI controller, the sounds are basically like soft, and then if you just increase in pressure just a tiny bit, it immediately maxes out. So it's kind of like you're somewhere like, your dynamics is gone. It's like you got either soft or hard, but in between it's very hard to just get that sensation right. And I've tried many things, couldn't find any solution to that. So on top, there's another problem with the MIDI is that it's so very buggy. Like the MIDI keyboard that I've connected to the Casio, sometimes uses one channel to play and sometimes another. So it's kind of like internally in the Casio, I never would believe this unless if I was struggling it with it myself, that the instruments that are in my keyboard as my primary instrument, which is usually the piano, and then my secondary instrument, which can be a flute or a reed instrument, whatever, you know, a lead, synth lead or whatever, I can put it on top here. It'll have difficulties like knowing which instrument it is. You've got three banks of instruments and each has four channels that work and the rest is MIDI channels, so for general MIDI. But the four out of the four, only one is your primary instrument for your secondary keyboard. And for some reason, I don't know what is going on, and I hope that Casio engineers are going to look into that. It is so difficult to get just a piano on the bottom and another instrument on the top. For some reason, it's always messing it up. It's always intertwining the instruments, shifting from one instrument to another, changing volumes, changing reverbs. And so you think after like a good 15 minutes of struggling, of adjusting it back, adjusting it again, you finally have the instrument setting that you want, for instance, a piano and a horn section or something. You think this is the instrument you want, it's set up the way you want it, so you go to bank and you store it in one of the four presets that you have on the keyboard. You register in one of the banks as a sound patch. It does not save the sound patch on the keyboard. It saves the sound patch on the Casio, the first, the primary instrument, but the secondary, it does not do. So it has a lot of issues and bugs that need to be worked out of the external MIDI keyboard input that you have on that Casio. What are other things that I've noticed about this keyboard that were not so very good that I thought would have improved? For instance, drum loops. There have been very little fusion jazz, modern jazz mainly, break beat kind of style. Also, it's more like when I talk about fusion, it's maybe funk fusion, kind of like 32 beats. Instead of the standard 4-beat or 8-beat rock, you got 16-beat rock, which is in there, but they don't have 32-beat fusion drum samples. Like, for instance, the Rolands, the Yamahas, everyone has all these nice and advanced drum loops. Like, for instance, the 4-beat pop music, pop drum loop would be like... And then you got the 16 beat, which is, it's kind of like a shuffle 16 beat. But anyway, the 32 beat will be like, so it's kind of like 32 beats before the drum loop is finished. And during that, they use more maybe funk style of drums. There's nothing in there that is funk style, and it's surprising because Casio has very funky demos in there. I wonder why they just did not put any funky drum patterns in there. That's kind of disappointing to me personally. What else have I noticed? The touchscreen is not a capacitive touchscreen. It has a touchscreen, it has a screen, and then it has a layer over it, a plastic layer. So you have to press the plastic layer as, you know, making contact with whatever's behind on the screen. So you can use your finger, you can use a pen, you can use anything that's hopefully not too sharp to press on your screen. The problem with it is that if you press it with your finger touches the screen like this, and maybe it rolls a little bit like that as you try to press. And that little bit of rolling makes the screen think that you're actually scrolling. So it wants to scroll the information rather than open the, like if you click on something, like you click, you tap on something, it should open the icon. And instead what happens is you tap it and your finger might move a little bit and it starts scrolling items to the right or to the left, thinking that you want to scroll, which is why it's too sensitive in the scrolling section. Sometimes I want to click on something and I have to click three times before it actually gets it. So I think that's a big issue. And then the complexity of it all. I mean, it's not easy to figure it out. I've been busy 3 days. It's not, I mean, they use a touchscreen interface and you got to get used to it. It gives you a lot of feedback information, but it doesn't come naturally on, for instance, how do I layer my instruments? Especially how do I get an extension keyboard plugged into the MIDI as a secondary sample using my Casio Privia, the PX360 soundboard. That's not easy at all. What is extremely hard as well is How do I layer my instruments in such a way that I can modify the bottom instrument? Like, my top instrument is a piano, and then my bottom instrument is a string, but as you can hear, strings are way too loud. So it's not easy to just figure out how can I modify the volume levels, and how can I like work on a patch and get that all done. I've not gone through the manual because I think that when you get a keyboard, you should figure things out yourself. But I believe that it is not easy to do this. It's not something that that you'd normally, you're probably going to have to check the manual to see how does this all work, because it's not self-explanatory. That's about it. I think those are the main issues that I find with this keyboard that do not work well. And I hope that that it benefits you. I know there are a lot of issues. And I don't want to say that this is a bad keyboard. If you want to buy the PX360, I would say it's best suited for a budget all-in-one kind of device. It's kind of like very basic song generation, where you can create your own songs, your instruments, your drum loops. You can put it all together. It's also very basic in stage piano. You can use it as a stage piano. And it's very basic in your home as a home piano. So it's kind of like, it's also very portable. So it has roundabout, it's good in everything, but it doesn't excel in everything. Even where it excels with is the acoustic piano sound. If I had to pay $800 for an acoustic piano, there are Yamaha pianos that are sold for about $500, $600 that have about the same keyboard feel and the same sound quality as this Casio. So if you'd ask me, I think the Casio is overpriced. I know it's a new thing, it's $800, but I think it is worth more like $600. Lastly, noise. It has noise, background noise, usually just like wind or like, you know, things like that. It has a noise gate. Noise gate is standard set to 3, so you don't hear it. But when you set it to 1, which is the lowest setting, you can hear all the, you can hear noise. You can hear very faint noise from like wind, like white noise or whatever it is. You can hear acoustics that Casio used when they sampled each string and each note. They sampled it with a microphone and they had acoustics. And when you play, for instance, a chord, you might not hear like 4 notes. You might hear a little bit of acoustic, you know, wind noises. But when you do, you know, those are like 2 or 3 chords at the same time. Every note that you play adds noise on each other. Your tones are the same, but your noise is being added. And so pretty soon when you're doing, I can hear it right now. I can hear shh right now, because it's almost sound like an AC unit or whatever, you know? It's in the background, the noise. I just don't know what to say about this. I mean, I'm surprised that I can actually hear this from a professional instrument. My Yamaha didn't have it. I mean, my Yamaha keyboard, the YPG-535, was on the same monitors, and I could play as many, it has a limit of 32 polyphony. Well, this one has, I believe, 128, if I'm not mistaken. But the Yamaha had a lot less of that noise. And so another thing that I thought that Casio could do better was the operating system boots up, takes about 15 to 20 seconds. I think that's long. They should have done it a lot faster. Like, you boot it up and it should be there within like 5 seconds the most, I think. 5 to 6 seconds. You just want to, you know. And they should have a live setting, a live display on the screen where you can just set your, instead of using the bank buttons, you should have a setting on the display where you can immediately tap one of 3 or 4 different instruments. On the screen it will be nice to have, I think. But you have the bank button, so it makes no sense that they're trying to get rid of buttons on the 350 and then they still have the bank buttons on the 360. So yeah, it's not a perfect instrument. It has a lot of issues. Not major issues, but it has issues. It's definitely not the best thing in the world. I think that Casio could definitely improve on it, on some of the things, especially the layered instruments, especially also speaker output. They should have some sort of an EQ in there, maybe like a 5 or 6 band EQ, where they can raise the output quality on the high frequencies and the low frequencies a little bit. Just, or even if it was just a button that says home, so you can have more of a curve like this, where the mid frequencies are higher than the lows and the highs, they would curve it like this, where you have more bass and more treble, which gives a more nicer tone at home when you're playing at home. So that's it. I hope that all these points can help you determine whether you want to buy this keyboard or not. There's plenty of sites out there that sell you this instrument as with all its positive points, and it definitely has positive points. I'm very happy with this piano sound. Not so happy as much with the incapability of layering instruments in a nice way to actually get a nice sample out of it. Yeah, that's it. And I'm going to upload it to YouTube. Hope you like it. And comment if you have any more questions, okay? Bye-bye.